पार्लियामेंट्री रिपोर्टर्स डिक्टेशन नंबर 47 एट द स्पीड ऑफ 160 वर्ड्स पर मिनट लास्ट 5 सेकेंड्स रेडी स्टार्ट सर द प्रेजिडेंट्स एड्रेस इज सपोज टू बी ए वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट डॉक्यूमेंट एंड इन दैट डॉक्यूमेंट इट इज एक्सपेक्टेड दैट ट्रू सिचुएशन शुड बी रिफ्लेक्टेड बट आई एम वेरी सॉरी टू से दैट ट्रू सिचुएशन इन द कंट्री अबाउट अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट about poverty, about discrimination between agriculture and industry is not reflected. If time permits, I will discuss about it in detail later on. So far as the communal situation in the country is concerned, it has been discussed at large and a satisfaction has been expressed by the president's address about the turn that it has taken in Punjab. It has been appreciated by the government, by the nation and by all the political parties. The stand taken by Barnala government and the Akali Dal. Very recently, they have declared politics and religion should not be mixed. Now, the Akali Dal itself with this experience, actually they are doing that. They were relying on religion and practicing religion and politics together. But now they have taken a different stand and it is a very welcome stand. But still, we have to see to what extent the Akali Dal withstand the pressure which is being developed in Punjab. Let us hope that they will withstand that pressure and act as they have declared that politics and religion should be separated. About other communal factors between Sikhs and Hindus, between Muslims and Hindus, this has taken a very serious turn in our country. What is happening in Ahmedabad? For pity, innocent lives of Muslims and of Hindus have been lost. Very recently, this communal riot took place only because a particular person was arrested. That particular person was said to be antisocial and he has been detained under the provisions of the law. But that outlaw has been elected in the Ahmedabad Corporation in 5 municipal constituencies. What will be the effect of this incident? The fact should be very well reflected where we are going now. A person who is anti-national, anti-social, a person who had been detained in the jail because of anti-social activities is being elected by the people of this country in 5 constituencies. Will this not have any bad effect on the people of this country? But according to me, nothing is being done by the government to stop this trend. It is a very easy to advise the Akali Dal that they should separate religion and politics. But what about the other political parties which are supposed to be secular and saying that they are secular parties allowing everybody to be a member of their own parties? Membership is not restricted to a particular religion, but coming to relying on religion and communal sentiments. Some papers are not only relying on religious and communal sentiments but also nursing religious and communal sentiments, including the ruling party. What has happened to the Muslim women's divorce bill? It was simply a fact that for nursing communal tendencies with a communal approach, that bill was passed, which was very clear to everybody in this house. If that is going to be the case, it will encourage communal feelings this way or that way, and it is going to destroy the whole nation. And I feel that all the political parties should understand this. They say that my friend has taken a good stand, that he has done a good thing, but we are not to be blamed. We are not blamed here because my friend is in the dock. We have put him in the dock. We are also in the dock, and we should be treated as persons responsible for this factor. Because the time at my disposal is not much, I will not deal with this matter in detail. Then I want to mention one or two other factors. The common man is concerned about the price increase. It is said in the address that there is a widening gap between the wholesale price index and the consumer price index. Simply saying that there is a gap between the wholesale price index and the consumer price index does not suffice. What are the attempts made by the government to eliminate this gap? There are no attempts to eliminate this gap because there is no attempt on the part of the government. The middleman is looting the consumer, he is looting the producer with the conscious connivance of the government. With the conscious connivance of the government, I have said, because it is the duty of the government to see that the consumer is not being looted. It is the duty of the government to see that the producer is not being looted. What has happened to the case of selling of garlic? The producer might have sold his goods at the rate of hardly rupees 10 or rupees 15 per kg, but in the market for some time it was being sold by the traders at the rate of rupees 60 per kg. Your Imperial Majesties have given our people the opportunity of welcoming you on other occasions in the past as well. Similarly, our leaders have visited your great country on numerous occasions. The exchange of views which have been made possible by these visits have invigorated the multidimensional relationship that exists between India and Iran. With every high-level visit that has been exchanged between our two countries, it has been possible to enlarge areas of cooperation and complementary and come closer together in our attitude to our and world problems. We have no doubt whatsoever that the present visit will impart further dynamism and vitality to the process of beneficial cooperation and mutual understanding between our two countries. The cultural and traditions of our two countries have much in common. India's context with Iran go back many thousand years in history and legends. There has been a continuous interleaf of thoughts, beliefs and ideas between the two countries. Anciently Pahlavi and modern Persian are akin to us, symbolizing the continuity of a great cultural tradition which has its roots in the ancient past and has influenced us and in turn has been influenced by us. It is therefore not surprising that we share so much common inheritance of the way of life of our two peoples in our customs and manners, arts and crafts, literature and lore, and above all in the common values which we have carefully nourished and cherished through the centuries. It is therefore only natural that we continue to share certain attitudes in our international and bilateral issues. Both our countries believe in the peaceful settlement of disputes through friendly discussions. In our relations with our neighbors, we have both consistently tried with sincerity and goodwill to foster ties of friendship and good neighborliness. Iran has been experiencing a phenomenal transformation under the dynamic and far-sighted leadership of your Imperial Majesty, and a social and cultural uplift under the inspiration of Her Imperial Majesty. Retaining the abiding values of a great civilization, your country is marching forward to reap the benefits of scientific and technological advancement. The remarkable progress achieved by Iran during the recent years stands testimony to your wisdom, foresight, and able stewardship. It can be truly said that the far-reaching economic endeavors which were inspired by your Imperial Majesty are and will continue to bear fruit in the future. In the evolution of an Iran holding its head high among the advanced nations of the world, India too has gone through momentous developments. The people of India have proved that they cherish their liberty above everything else. After the massive mandate which our people have given to the present government, a great responsibility rests upon our shoulders. We are bending our energies and applying all our strength for quickening the pace of progress in the country and to give material content to our political liberty. In this achievement, we recognize the value of assistance and cooperation which we have received from Iran under the personal interest and direction of your Imperial Majesty. Regrettably, the world today continues to present a disconcerting picture of contracts and disparities. This is the gravest threat to international peace and security. Deprivation cannot coexist without inviting questioning, discontent, and frustration. The gulf between the haves and have-nots must be bridged if we wish this planet to remain peaceful and stable. It is therefore the duty of all of us to ensure that we make this planet a better place for succeeding generations through progressive elimination of disparities and want and achievement of all-round and accelerated progress of the underdeveloped world. Each of us has his own role to play according to capacity and capability. It is only through collective efforts that we will be able to succeed. In this context, we would like to pay a tribute to your Imperial Majesty's own efforts in helping the to undertake ventures of common benefits on the basis of bilaterals. Your Imperial Majesty has crusaded for the removal of barriers restricting the flows of trade, commerce, and communications between the developed and the developing countries. Your effort for mitigating the present world economic situation is a measure of your statesmanship as well as of your deep understanding of the complementary of the economic forces of the world. I am firmly of the view that both our countries can play a significant role in broadening the trend for greater harmony and understanding between the North and South. Between our two countries, the possibilities of cooperation are virtually limitless. We are happy to observe that many of the projects envisaged by our governments earlier are now taking concrete shape. Stop.